Hey there, weirdos of YouTube. Me and Kyle have been talking, and we have decided that since a majority of our time when we get together is spent toward the main show, we're going to take our time apart to kind of each take on a little pet project of our own. He's been going hard on the Patreon, and I've decided to throw my hand at YouTube. I feel like it's a platform that doesn't get a lot of extra love from us. So I'm gonna try to video edit some stuff and we're gonna try to divide and conquer and put out as much content as we can for all of you. So I'm just gonna look into some stories, maybe even go on to do some lives on here, maybe have some other content creators, other YouTubers, other podcasters come on and we'll talk about weird stuff and, basically just do what we do. So bear with me. I've never did any video editing before, so it's probably going to be archaic at best, but I figure it's a way to get some extra content out there for you guys. So, hope you enjoy.
Extra-dimensional beings.
Everybody, welcome back to the show. Only one half of us here today. I am Steve, of course. As I n noted in the beginning of the video, me and Kyle have decided to try to make the most of our time and split things up a little bit, kind of focus on different platforms and avenues to kind of branch out and go on our own to produce more content. We're not going to deviate away from the main show, but we're just going to utilize the fact that there's two of us to kind of reach out and divide and conquer. So we're going to put out start putting out more and more content for everyone. That being said, I'm going to kind of dip my toes in the world of YouTube here, try some video editing, and put together some extra content for you all. So today I have pulled up a couple stories of towns in the US that have seemingly disappeared. Kind of crazy. We've all heard of the lost colony of Roanoke, which I will touch on a little bit, kind of as a precursor to show that these things do, in fact, happen and have happened throughout history. So, according to history.com here, the origins of one of the oldest unsolved mysteries can be traced to August of 1587, when a group of about 115 English settlers arrived on Roanoke Island, off the coast of what is now North Carolina. Later that year, it was decided that John White, governor of the new colony, would sail back to England in order to gather a fresh load of supplies. But just as he arrived, a major naval war broke out between England and Spain. Queen Elizabeth I called on every available ship to confront the mighty Spanish armada. In August of 1590, White finally returned to Roanoke, where he left his wife and daughter, his infant granddaughter, and the settlers of 3 long years before. He found no trace of the colony nor its inhabitants, and few clues to what might have happened apart from a single word, Croatoan, carved into a wooden post. There have been tons of investigations over the centuries to try to find a satisfactory answer to where the colonists went, but speculation is pretty much all we have at this point. Were they abducted or killed by local Native Americans, abducted by aliens, just kind of vanished into thin air, transported into another dimension? Who knows? But The fact is that this was not a single occurrence, so to speak. Throughout history, there are other occurrences of towns just simply vanishing. So I figured I would talk to you about some of those. The first one I have here, it is the disappearance of the village at Lake Andacuni. During a hard winter in 1930, a fur trapper named Joe LaBelle was exploring the northern part of a specific area in Canada when he decided to seek shelter during a blizzard. He had visited this area many times before, and Lake Andacuni was an active spot for trappers and traders. When he entered the village, though, all he found was silence. There was nobody. After his initial foot search, it became clear that the village had been abandoned in a hurry. He found fire still smoking, food still cooking in large pots, and he even found plates of food like they were mid-dinner when they had got up and left. Upon more exploration, he discovered that some of the homes of the villagers still had all their weapons. They had large stocks of food that they just left and lots of their belongings, including their winter wares, which they would need to be out in this blizzard, were still in their homes. What he didn't find was all the 30 men, women, and children that called the village home. He found no trace of anyone. In his mind, he had suspected that something terrible had happened, knowing that they would never desert a habitable place for no reason or leave behind all of their resources. After he inspected a storehouse, he found that it was still full of food, full of trout and elk and whatnot. He went to search for a reason behind their sudden exit, egress, if you will. He could find no footprints in any of the snow, and he found that their sled dogs were still there. Again, all their weapons and everything were still there. Just essentially like they had got up and just disappeared. He went on to call the Royal Canadian Mounted Police, who arrived at the town and met with LaBelle. While they were there and searching, they discovered some more strangeness going on in and around the town or the village of Lake Andacuni. On the outskirts of the town, in the village burial grounds, they found that all of the graves had been opened and the occupants inside were also missing. So not only did the living inhabitants of Lake Andacuni disappear, the dead did also. The desecration of a resting place for a body is not only an illegal act in most communities, but it's considered a heinous taboo to the Inuit people. The Mounties did not believe it to be work of animals, given that the ground was frozen solid, and unearthing the bodies would require essentially tons of labor and tools. The presence of stacked rocks next to each grave added to the suspicion that the bodies were dug up. The Mounties immediately ordered a search party for the missing villagers, but failed to find any evidence of where the villagers were or what had happened to them. They did, however, discover a pack of sled dogs on the outskirts of the village that had died of starvation before being covered by snow. This unnerved the search party, considering such massive stores of food and shelter were just a short walk away from where the dogs had reportedly died. Some historical researchers later claim that the dogs had been tied up where they were found. Still leaves question as to how they managed to die so quickly when it was apparent that the villagers who were there had simply got up and vanished mid-meal. If that didn't make this story weird enough, the Royal Canadian Mounted Police stated that they had been seeing mysterious pulsing lights in the sky above Lake Andacuni while they were out investigating the scene. Of course, that's not anything too weird, considering you have the Aurora Borealis and stuff up in the Canadian North, but if you tie the two together, it does make you question whether or not this was an abduction of some otherworldly type. They said that the lights that they saw on the horizon were bluish and pulsing, quite unlike the northern lights, which, like most of this case, ended up not ever being explained, but you put everything together, and it is definitely weird. After a long investigation, the RCMP officers used berries found nearby to determine that the villagers had been gone for almost 2 months. This begged the question, who had been using their village site if they were gone, and why? The first press account of the ordeal appeared in the newspaper Le Pas, Manitoba, where a reporter published a story on the disappearance in November 1930. Shortly thereafter, another newspaper, the Danville Bee of Quebec, published a story as well. The report that propelled the case into the national spotlight was an article published by the Halifax Herald, and they labeled the abandoned location the Village of the Dead. The story went on to be pressed in countless newspapers across the country, eventually just kind of fading out of the limelight for more pressing stories. In 1959, an author, Frank Edwards, included this story in a book that he published called Stranger Than Science. This earned the attention of the RCMP again, who now claim that the event never happened and that Edwards had made it up to improve book sales. Though many agree that Edwards had more than likely embellished much of the story for his book, the fact remains the same that there are documented press accounts from the 1930s about the disappearance. There are also records of two investigations carried out by the RCMP on the event, with the latter taking place in 1931. So now they're kind of flip-flopping, saying, hey, this never took place, but they have files of the investigations from 1931. This kind of sparked new interest in the case, and further research was conducted in the two investigations. It came forward that LaBelle was new to the Northern Territories and not a seasoned trapper like he claimed to be. It also came to light that the original reporter who broke the story was well known to be a sensationalist journalist and would often embellish stories about the Wild North for the sake of dramatics. You know, drama sells, so he would spice up his newspapers a little bit. The final word on the matter is that LaBelle was an inexperienced trapper who didn't have the knowledge or experience as to know what he saw at the village, and that the newspaper guy kind of made it up. So, as with anything throughout history, facts and fiction kind of get mixed together, and it's hard to differentiate what actually happened. The bottom line is that there was a village that was abandoned in the 1930s. There were investigations to find the people, which they didn't, and the circumstances were definitely bizarre. So, again, it makes you wonder what had happened. You know, they saw the lights in the sky. Was this a mass UFO abduction? Was it, you know, did the people just decide to pack up and try to find another place to live? Granted, they didn't pack up because they left everything. So you almost throw that out the window. Also, you have the Wendigo culture that is a big part of Northern Canada and the Great White North. So that is another theory that's thrown out there, that maybe it was some malevolent spirit that came in and just wiped the earth clean of these people. I do not know. I wish I had an answer, but that's why I'm bringing this to you guys. I'm going to present you with some of the information, and you can come to your own conclusion. If you'd like to, my source on this was theoccultmuseum.com. Go over there and check it out. They got a really good write-up on it. You can find the information and kind of come to your own conclusions. From there, I got some more recent ones. I don't know if they are creepypastas, if they're legit. It is too hard to even decide. It's the internet is a wild place, folks, as you know. It is crazy. So coming across stuff and trying to differentiate it is I'm just here to present this information that I found. One from kind of the same time period as Lake Anjikuni is Urkhammer, Iowa. I'm on obscurelegend.fandom.com. They have all kinds of cool stuff over there, so we're going to talk about it. Urkhammer is said to have been a small Midwestern town, which is said to have vanished without a trace in 1928. The story of Urkhammer first appeared online in 2015, when an author of the website Strange State, Colin Hudson, shared what appeared to be a historical overview of the town that his mother had received in an email. here is the email that his mother received. I will read it in full. One recalls the town of Urquhamar, Iowa during the 1920s and early 30s. For years, people passed by the bustling burg of Urquhamar without giving it a second thought. Many people even drove through it, and there are rumors that transactions took place between tourists and the pale, mute Urquhamarovians. Nice. In 1928, the first ontological doubts about the town began when aerial photographs showed only empty fields where there should have been homes, and streets and stores surrounded by farms and waving fields of grain. A week or so later, a lost tourist had his marmot speedster topped off at a gas station at the Urquhamar, or topped off with gasoline at the Urquhamar SO station, then, 2 miles beyond the town borders, discovered that his tank was empty. He walked back to demand a refund from the conniving general store and gas pump emporium, only discovered that regardless of how far he walked, the town remained the same distance ahead of him. Fortunately, another motorist picked him up and after an hour or two replenished his car's fuel supply, but the man had been shaken to the core and required a prolonged sojourn in an Alpine sanatorium. In 1929, the Davenport Clarion Sun Telegraph newspaper published both stories. Doubtlessly, there would have been a strong public reaction had this story not appeared in the same issue of the paper as the Wall Street stock market crash. In the following week's edition, the last before the Clarion Sun Telegraph itself failed, was a strong protest from an apparent resident of Urquhamar, a certain Fatima Morgana, disputing the apparent non-existence of the town and relating her life story there as a school teacher and an anti-Saloon League activist. But her letter to the editor was lost in one of the plant closings, stockbroker suicides, and the sudden popularity of apple sellers on street corners. Urquhamar's own newspaper, the Weekly Bugle Advertiser, ran a now classic headline, rumors of our non-existence have been greatly exaggerated, for which they were sued by the estate of the late Samuel Clemens, which is Mark Twain. Urquhamar remained undisturbed throughout the 1930 and 1931. Passersby still waved at children playing in backyards as they passed on Route 41. Although there was little traffic now, and much of it was by horse-drawn wagon as farmers attempted to save their old homesteads by traveling to larger city to vend their wares. But disaster struck in 1932 when a convoy of Illinois farm families fleeing the ruins of the Dust Bowl farms from California decided to spend the night on the outskirts of Urquhamar. Two of these wandering souls pulled the camp's meager store of pennies and nickels and went into the town to buy necessary supplies. There was always a risk in entering town since illies and okies were rumored to be thieves as well as vagabonds and were not welcomed by townspeople. The men plodded to the general store, pausing for a moment to check the gasoline prices at the pumps outside before entering. Imagine their surprise when they were unable to mount the steps leading to the store, their feet each time passing through the lowermost step as though through a cloud. Convinced that this was some sort of plot to prevent outsiders from shopping at the store, they attempted to scale the steps using an old board found nearby. Imagine their surprise again when their feet passed through both the board and the steps, as easy as, quote, a potato passes through the smoke of a campfire. Terrified, the men ran back to their nomadic camp and reported what they had seen, only to be accused of spending the group's hard-earned money on illegal hooch rather than beans and bacon. But they displayed the money and challenged the others in the camp to try the same experiment. A group of over a dozen men, some armed, went back to the general store, and lo and behold, the same eerie experience. The caravan covered its fires and decamped with all deliberate speed, and the story quickly circulated. Soon, a group of state police were ordered to investigate the phenomenon. They went to Urquhamar Sheriff's Office to confer, converse, and otherwise hobnob with the brother and law enforcement officials. The group's leader approached the office of this guardian of the peace and attempted to knock on the door, only to see his hand pass through the thick oak as it were merely painted steam. The report began the gradual decline of Urquhamar. It became less substantial with every passing day, and passerby noticed the absence of children playing in the growing seediness of the houses and barns. Then on May 7th, 1932, an immigrant farmer passed by at dawn with his cargo of produce, and what did he see? But nothing. Where the town had stood, only abandoned fields and long-rotted fences. Cast iron bathtub used long ago as a watering trough for livestock sat alone in a field of weeds. The sole relic of human presence, Urquhamar was no more. Many years later, a gypsy caravan camped on the site but left abruptly. The adamant of the group stated that the place was saturated with the tears of the dispossessed and with the despair of those who had never borne names. So that's the story of Urkhammer. Most likely it's an internet urban legend, but it begs you to question how much of this really happens, you know? Like, the explanation here states that it's an urban legend. However, the story was quickly repeated on Mysterious Universe and other sites without mentioning certain details. The newspaper mentioned in the account above never existed, so all evidence points to this being a pure internet legend. There are other similar internet tales like Elsewhere, Kentucky and Ashley, Kansas, who are kind of in the same vein here, but they are specifically creepypastas. This is one of those ones that kind of may have blurred the lines, but again, doing some investigation and seeing that the newspaper didn't even exist makes you kind of lean on the side that this is probably not factual. But again, there are some other ones that are a little closer to our time frame here and definitely makes you wonder. Next, we have Langville, Montana. Langville, Montana was supposedly a small rural town which disappeared in the early 2000s, and of which online discussion and evidence has been apparently erased. Appearing in Google searches, autocompletes, and recommended search options under the intriguing titles such as Langville, Montana Incident, Langville, Montana Disappeared, and most bizarrely, Langville, Montana Turned Inside Out. But upon clicking on any of these links, the search yields nothing, leading investigators to suspect that not only had the town disappeared, but all data on it being expunged also disappeared from the internet. The story again has become somewhat of an internet legend as the other ones that I had mentioned previously. It was also referenced in the Ghostbuster sequel, which kind of makes you wonder if this was a publicity campaign involved in the suggested searches. But since it doesn't bring up anything, that is either a pretty profound search or a pretty profound campaign, or it's nothing at all. However, in some of the reviews of the movie, Montana locals did come forth referencing that Langville did, in fact, exist. So again, it kind of leads you to whether or not this is actually a true account, or if it's a hoax. Was it a real town that just disappeared supernaturally, or like conspiratorially had been erased? Maybe something had come up, some sort of military test goes on, and they just raised the town, just leveled it and any existence of it. Or maybe it was just a publicity stunt for the film. I don't know. It's a crazy world. Crazier things have happened. Last one I've got here is Dublin, Wisconsin, which doesn't have a whole lot of information, but this one is the most bizarre to me. So bear with me here. Dublin, Wisconsin. Dublin, Wisconsin was supposedly a small town which somehow disappeared in the 1990s. Some people in Wisconsin allegedly have shirts, mugs, and souvenirs from the town. Some even remember it and had relatives who had previously lived there. For the background, outside of memories and stories from relatives, there are also mugs, shirts bearing Dublin's name. There was also a digital ghost trace of Dublin, or Dublin, in the form of a Google search autocorrect and recommended search option suggesting the term Dublin, Wisconsin to many users without bringing up any results. This phenomenon is similar to Langville, Montana. Unlike that vanished town, no ARG or online publicity campaign can be linked to Dublin, which first started appearing in online mentions in 2015. Theories produced by people who have looked into it are it's just a tall tale or internet legend. There's not a whole lot of evidence or information that this town could be explained as a cover-up, so most likely it's just an urban legend or kind of like a mass online delusion. It's a town that was possibly destroyed by like damming water. Towns that vanish this way are usually historically well documented, though. It's been suggested that the t-shirts and mugs associated with Dublin might be examples as bot-generated advertisements based on recent search history. So we know how the internet works. You talk about it and shit like this pops up. Could it just be a town that disappeared from economic strain? it happens a lot. Granted, it doesn't happen overnight, but there are ghost towns everywhere, especially in the Midwest. You look around, you'll find a failed town. So that's another possibility. Could be destroyed by the state due to a military experiment gone wrong. We all know that that is also a possibility. They could have went in there, tried something out, saw that it was not the way that they had planned, and just decided to disappear everyone. Definitely wouldn't put it past the military, of course. One of my biggest theories that I came across here that just kind of blows my mind is the idea of a hyperstition, or an idea which functions retrocausally to bring about their own reality. In short, although it did not exist at first, the idea of Dublin and these other missing towns told in modern stories may retroactively grant it some foothold in reality. So the idea of this hyperstition just kind of blows my mind, that you can bring forth something into reality by mentioning it enough, almost like a tulpa. Yeah, almost like a tulpa. Like how Slender Man came to fruition via creepypastas, and then all of a sudden sightings of the Slender Man increased. It almost makes you wonder, like, is this all part of a simulation? You know what I mean? Like, the more we think about it and the more we put into it, the more that it becomes real. Like, our collective thought on Dublin, Wisconsin, all of a sudden starts producing tourist material from Dublin, Wisconsin, coffee mugs, t-shirts, all that shit. Like, it makes you wonder how powerful the brain is, how powerful our collective consciousness is on the world around us, on our existence around us. Can we change the past the more we think about it now? It's almost like a Mandela effect, but only like, well, it is kind of like the Mandela effect. Like, the more we think about it, the more that it becomes factual. I don't know. It's bizarre. There are some notable accounts here. I just learned of all the noise surrounding Dublin. I think I can add some insight. Dublin was a small town in Wisconsin that housed a lot of military families. My father lived there for a year or two and spoke of it occasionally. The main thing I remember is that it had to do with a Project Sanguine in the early 1960s. I don't think it was X-Files type stuff, but the town was destroyed after an incident. I thought they were digging up a ton of land for something and they flooded the town or something of that sort. But this is a rehashed secondhand memory from years ago. I looked up Project Sanguine for you guys, and it is a legit thing. Project Sanguine was a U.S. Navy project proposed in 1968 for communication with submerged submarines using extremely low frequency radio waves. The original proposed system, hardened to survive a nuclear attack, would have required giant antenna covering 2/5 of the state of Wisconsin. Because of protests and potential environmental impact, the proposed system was never implemented. A similar, less hardened system called Project ELF consisted of 2 linked ELF transmitters located near Clam Lake, Wisconsin, and Republic, Michigan, was built beginning in 1982 and operated from 1989 till 2004. Some say that the experiments with these extreme low frequencies could have damaged the town, or the town was directly linked to this and then raised after the project went south. Another state, locations for Dublin don't coincide with Project Sanguine due to the bedrock. There are 2 ELF sites no longer in operation, with one being outside Clam Lake and the other in the Upper Peninsula. These are extremely low-frequency transmitters that use the bedrock to bounce signals under the crust to signal nuclear submarines to surface and receive action messages. The antenna were above the ground and looked like power lines running through the middle of the forest. If the antennas were buried, then they would short out the earth ground and be useless. There's nothing sci-fi about Sanguine, and nothing that could cause an accident where a town would disappear, but there have been studies about possible increase in cancer due to the power and frequencies used at these sites. That's another possibility. Maybe Project Elf and Project Sanguine made an uptick in the cancer of the population of the town, and they came in and they just dispersed everyone. They said, you know, you guys need to get out of here. It's not safe to live here. They just ghost towned it, and it kind of became its own thing here. As someone who lived in various places in Wisconsin for 30 years, has been in the Army, and never once heard a single person ever mention Dublin. I think you make a good point, but Dublin was very real. My father used to mention occasionally before he passed, and the only reason I remember it is because I found it ironic that a town named Dublin was populated almost exclusively by military personnel and their families. I'll dig around for a shirt when I get back home next in early September. If I remember correctly, the town was built as a part of Project Sanguine in the mid-1960s. Maybe everyone left when the project was canceled, but I thought something went very, very wrong. You can only dig up that much turf for so long before you're bound to have problems. The freaky part about this is how many people in my family from Wisconsin say they actually remember Dublin. So I don't know. I'm thinking hyperstition, man. The fact that Dublin never existed, but it's slowly, granted retroactively, forcing its way into our reality the more we talk about it. Starting with the souvenirs and the Google search predictions, and then as decades go on, Dublin may not only exist, but it will have always existed. I just thought these were kind of interesting little tidbits. Again, I don't know if they're factual. I don't know if they're creepypastas. All I do know is that they're weird, and that's what we're all about. So I'm going to try to piece together a little video here for you all. I hope it turns out all right. Bear with me. It's weird doing this by myself without Kyle. I definitely wish he was here to bounce these ideas off of, because working as a pair, it flows so much easier than sitting here talking to myself into a microphone. I'm sure it'll get better with time. He said he's struggling with the same thing over at the Patreon, just doing shit on his own. But like I said, we're going to try to get some lives going, get some other creators in here to bounce ideas off of. And until then, I'm going to keep going with these little weird blurbs that aren't quite big enough to hold their own show, but I can put them together and maybe post some pictures and stuff here, do a little video editing, and get them out to you guys. So I would like to know what you all think on some of these cases I'm going to bring forward. So as far as the Vanishing Towns go, is it an internet mystery? Is it a creepypasta? Are we retroactively creating history that never happened, but now it will have always happened? I don't know. I can't wrap my head around it. And for the Roanoke and for the Lake Anjikuni, where did all those people go? You know, alternate reality, different dimension, mass alien abduction, military weirdness. Who knows? But that's my little blurb for today. So until we meet again, stay weird, stay safe. And if your town disappears, try to call in before it does. Just let us know. We need the information. No.